Good news, we're back with another episode of Armchair Architects, the Azure Enablement series that's an ongoing conversation with Eric and Uli, two of the smartest architects I know. This episode, we're going to talk about architecting mission-critical apps. How do you build things that are mission-critical and stay running no matter what? So join us. Hey, welcome back to the Azure Enablement Show, Armchair Architects episodes. So today we're in for like a really super cool one for me, who's like into this reliability world. We're going to talk about how does architecture intersect with those applications and systems and services that have to be always on, that are, I guess the term is mission critical. And so I'd like to welcome Uli and Eric back. And I want to talk to you to find out, like, why isn't architecture the same for mission critical apps as it is for any other app? Like, don't we want everything to be running all the time? And wouldn't we design it that way anyway?
My thought process is we'd like it to be a consistent set of architectural principles for everything from the small to the large. But in general, I think when you're building mission critical applications, we need to think about things in terms of those uber important architectural patterns and characteristics of these systems. So the way I think about mission critical apps is understanding that there's going to be failure resident within these applications at some componentry level. The only difference here with mission critical applications, in my estimation, is what happens when one of those application components are under a system of, or an outage. How graceful can your user experience be? Can you employ some of the techniques we talked about in season one to increase reliability and then potentially self-heal and self-recover such that the failure is transient, but the users of that mission critical application never know the difference, no data is lost, no transactions are sacrificed?
Uli, what do you think, or do you think we need to treat this class of applications differently from any other class of applications?
The story is very fairly simple. I mean, on the one side, we talked about cost in the first episode of season two. And if you have a mission critical environment, which simply means that your business, life, or whatever is super important to you is at risk if this application fails. Let's take 911 in the US as a calling system for emergency services. If that is down, people are at risk. And therefore, you have to make sure that the system is available. If you are running a business, we talked about the Black Friday example where shopping websites need to be up and running because there's a lot of business that runs through there. And if your system is not up, you might put the business that you're serving at risk. So for me, mission critical is always subjective in terms of what mission are you serving. Hmm. Sometimes it's as extreme as life are at risk. Sometimes it's the business is at risk. But at the end of the day, it's a subjective decision. But once you make that decision that this application, this system, solution, whatever the word is you want to use, is mission critical, then you need to go and change gears, which also includes a cost conversation because a mission critical system is more expensive to host, operate, maintain, and so forth than a system that has only, let's say, taken two nines as an availability measure. And that might be good enough for a lot of stuff, but for the key pieces that really run your business, you want a higher level of availability, robustness, and so forth.
But is it a matter of just like throwing more money at the problem? Like, I mean, I know we were talking about cost before, but it's like, cool, I've just bought the largest tier you got with like lots and lots of GPUs or something. Like, am I mission critical now because I have a large bill?
I don't think it's, as with many things, David, I don't think it's that simple, but I do think it begins, the way to answer that question, I think, is to take the first step in classifying the critical nature of the system. If you can understand the classification system, or you have one already that exists, the goal would be for you to say this system or its components, because they serve multiple systems that might have different levels of mission criticality, it's too big to fail. It can't have more than 5 minutes of downtime a year. Those types of classifications will help you as you begin to take this to your decision makers to justify the investment required if they want that particular level of service. It also has a backwards effect to determine whether or not you make modifications to the system architecture or you actually have alternative scale units, as we talked about in the last session, around how I actually scale this system and make it available or highly available based on the criticality.
Yeah, so I want to bring it back to the architecture patterns that Eric mentioned in the beginning. At the end of the day, mission critical is effectively a usage of different architecture patterns. We have, for example, talked about active-active. Mm-hmm. You don't do that with systems that don't need to be available because it's really expensive. Running two systems in completely different regions, making sure that they are load balanced and so forth, that's expensive. You have to do that for a system which is critical to you, the mission that you are serving. And ultimately, it all comes down to those kind of architecture patterns that you utilize versus and these services that you utilize, because GPUs, having more or less of them, is obviously not the criteria.
Right.
But if you have a state management system like a database or storage, you want to be able to say, oh, wow, this storage can never really fail and I can't lose the data. Therefore, I need to replicate it into another region, potentially multiple regions, so that if the real disaster happens, the business is still able to serve. Again, 911 in the US is the calling system for the emergency services. And so when we supported the New York City state with this capability, we ran the primary system on Azure and a backup system on premises. And that backup system was a hot standby, not an active-active system, but a hot standby that could take over just in case the Azure region that serves as a primary had a problem or stuff like that. And that's really the difference between non-mission critical capabilities and mission critical capabilities.
And mission critical doesn't necessarily mean instantaneous, right? I mean, it means things keep on going if there's a failure. There are certainly some things like the 911 example where you're not like, call back in an hour, I'm sure things will be fine, right? But there are also ones where like, okay, if it doesn't immediately trigger the order, and it triggers it 5 minutes later because I had a failover to something, that's okay as well. So it seems like mission critical is not just one big bucket of must always work all the time at the same speed it was working before, right?
I would agree with that. Again, it goes back to that point about criticality and classification. If you can do that classification, the role of an architect or a solution designer would say, okay, well, what does that translate into in terms of reliability and security and network connectivity and how does that impact my health modeling and my pen testing and any operational procedures that need to be in place to support this? So I think that those are the design areas in which you begin to flesh out based on the categorization of the criticality of the system.
Yeah, I want to put a little bit of an illumination on the concept Eric just pointed out. Let's take an imaginary system that has two components, two workloads. One is a video stream of a sports event, and the other one is a social capability around that sports event. If you are on the day of this sport event, all of a sudden the video stream becomes mission critical because people are sitting in front of the TV or on the internet browser and watching the sport event. And obviously they want to see the event. Otherwise, why would they watch this at this point in time? Because the provider offer also is video on demand later, but people love to watch sport events in real time. And the social component, while important, is actually not as mission critical. People will forgive you if this is a bit slow or it's not quite there. They're not happy, they will be grumpy, but they won't be absolutely mad at you. If the video feed fails while the game is on, you actually certainly are in trouble. And the situation most likely reverses once the game has been played. Now people want to talk about the game. So now the social component becomes far more important than the video on demand, where people might say, yeah, okay, I'll come back in an hour because all of a sudden this. So think about workloads, which is really the characteristics in terms of what you're thinking about, and then also timing. It isn't necessarily black and white. This is mission critical and this isn't. It also can depend on the time of day, the situation that you're in and so forth, and being able to vary the architecture patterns and be able to turn things on and off, I think is going to be the art form that people have to think about.
And I love this example, Uli, because in order to make those detections and to understand when the video signal is degrading or the social platform is showing signs of fatigue or contention, you need robust health modeling. You want a scenario in which your mission critical application tells you as the owner that there is a problem before it becomes widespread, before it becomes noticeable by customers, and certainly before they call you or start tweeting that there is a problem. And so robust health monitoring, which includes architecture in terms of observability patterns, pipelines, logs, metrics, all those things, you need to have a way of emitting that telemetry, but also aggregating that telemetry, running inferences across it to say, hey, it looks like people from this particular region watching in the, on these devices are showing network contention. They've dropped down from 4K to 1080p to 720p. Looks like there's going to be a problem there. Here's what we do about it.
Gosh, I want to go that direction because monitoring and observability is close to my heart, but I find myself wondering whether one of the hallmarks of mission critical architecture is the capacity or the importance or the ability to switch design patterns on the fly. Like to respond, like is a key part of what an architect does when they're designing these things, constructing things so that different patterns swap in at the right time, or are mission critical situations design pattern stable at most of the time?
Yeah, I don't know about you, Uli. I've never run into a circumstance in which you reach a point in an application's lifecycle and you're like, quick, let's switch to the beta design pattern instead of the alpha one. But I do, what you said there, David, made me did think of a scenario in which you are in a situation where you've anticipated, thanks to your observability pipeline and your health modeling, you've observed a problem state and you're like, oh, wow, the application as it exists today in production, we can't deal with this. We didn't foresee it. Quick, let's figure out what we need to do. Let's scale test it. Let's deploy it as quickly as possible into those specific regions or across the entire implementation so we can fix this before it becomes an issue. So there's almost an element of deployment and testing in terms of CI/CD and being able to fix things quickly so that the system doesn't just come down, I think is really important.
Well, I was thinking design patterns, I was thinking about a previous conversation we had about load shedding. And I was thinking that like a switch in design pattern is load sharding. And then, we're in trouble. So now we can go to a load shedding instead of shard, you know, like instead of putting it out everywhere, we switch to a shedding model where we're in a different way of thinking. And I'm just wondering if is that something we can say abstractly is true in general, that you want to be able to have a contingency pattern that is already built into the system ready to go? Is that an accurate statement for how to deal with faults that are latent in complex systems?
I think, David, the key that you're pointing out is composition of architecture patterns and solutions into an end-to-end capability. Uh-huh. Again, let's go back to this sport event capability. Actually, there were three workloads we described. We described a real-time event. We described a social media and a video on demand, which is a different solution. It might reuse some of the capabilities of the real-time capability, but it's not the same. And therefore, you can vary the cost and reliability and availability patterns accordingly because you have flexibility. And that means you also use then various patterns that are effectively going on against this, again, load balancing, elasticity, load shedding, right, or throttling. All of those are fair game. And obviously something that is not just for mission-critical systems. Mission-critical systems mostly deal with availability and reliability, meaning you cannot have the system fail if disaster strikes. Let's say you are in a specific region, that entire region is out. That system has to still be available. And that system ideally is made out of multiple parts, not necessarily many parts, but multiple parts, so that you can determine based upon requirements, time of day, whatever it might be, how to make this capability available in a specific level of availability or robustness. Because again, building super robust systems, meaning making them available in multiple areas, does cost money, and therefore it has to be planned out for the right reasons and not just because you can.
So once again, you gentlemen have sucked me into a direction, whether I liked it or not, when we're talking about monitoring observability and we're talking about availability and understanding how to handle situations there, even if we haven't planned for them, right? Because that's kind of a little bit of what we were getting into, is that question about, like, it's cool if you have a priori knowledge as to how things are going to fail, but it's a lot harder if you don't. And it occurs to me that there is one thing that people are starting to do in my world to try to determine this and to try to get a sense of, like, well, what do I do about things that I don't know about yet? And that's the land of chaos engineering. This is something we promised we'd talk about last season, and we didn't get to it, but I can wait no longer. So if you're up for it, I would really like to talk about chaos engineering, because that's going to be a fun conversation if you're up for it.
Can't wait.
Cool. Well, I want to thank you all for watching this. I'm hoping you'll join us on the next episode, which now you watching it now know ahead of other people what it's going to be, where we're going to talk a little bit about chaos engineering with Uli and Eric. So please join us again on another episode of Armchair Architects as part of the Azure Enablement Show.